In this video, we are going to look at specific tips that should help you at the lab bench. The first step for successful restriction enzyme cloning is to use directional cloning whenever possible. Within the narrowed arena of directional cloning, there are some details that improve your outcome, which we will discuss for the next few minutes. Successful restriction cloning using two restriction enzymes starts with abundant double-cut vector that has a minimal background, as well as clean, fully digested insert. The steps to do that are listed here. Cut your vector and insert with the required restriction enzymes. Purify your linearized molecules away from the enzymes and small fragment byproducts. Quantify your fragments. Be sure you set up a vector-only ligation reaction when performing your ligations. Optionally, you can treat your double-cut vector with phosphatase. This will prevent re-ligation of stray vector that was only cut with one of the enzymes. Now let's talk about restriction digestion of your vector and insert using two enzymes. In separate tubes, you will have set up the enzyme digests. So far, we have probably made restriction enzymes seem infallible. Like many things in biology, they have their quirks. Some enzymes are particular about the salt conditions where they are active. The effect of putting an enzyme in the wrong salt conditions range from no activity to acquiring star activity. Star activity is lowered recognition site specificity, i.e. enzyme cutting where you do not want it. All enzymes are provided with buffers which optimize their cutting activity, both specificity and kinetics. Different manufacturers have different sets of buffers for their enzymes with 3 to 5 buffers that allow for efficient cutting by their enzymes. Many enzymes will be fully active in the same buffer. If this is the case, you can put both enzymes in at the same time. Be sure not to let the combined volumes of the enzymes exceed 10% of the reaction volume. If you have chosen enzymes with completely incompatible reaction conditions, you should perform the reaction stepwise. First, digest your DNA with enzyme 1. When that digest is complete, inactivate or eliminate enzyme 1 from the reaction and set up digest conditions for enzyme 2. If the buffers are relatively similar, differing in salt concentration, but not other additives, you can perform the digest, which requires the lower salt concentration first, then shift the entire reaction to the higher salt concentration and add the second enzyme. Ultimately, you need to be sure your DNA vector and insert have been cut to completion. A small sample can be run on a gel, or the complete sample can be BAM purified. Partially cut vector can recircularize and contribute to background colonies. Partially cut insert will lower ligation efficiency by blocking ligation of fully cut insert. The best practice is to gel purify your double cut vector and insert. This can take some time, but is worth the effort achieving both objectives. If this is a cloning vector enzyme pair you think you may use again, do not be shy about making a substantial quantity. If extraneous DNA fragments are particularly small, you might be able to use a PCR cleanup column, but don't be surprised if you have some background this way. BAM purification is preferred because it also lets you separate linearized vector from any residual uncut vector, an artifact that cannot be removed with DNA cleanup columns. We are now going to change gears and talk about the ligation itself. In a classic ligation, you need to provide relatively precise amounts of DNA, both vector and insert. Ideally, you want 2 to 3 times as many molecules of insert as you have molecules of vector. This is called the molar ratio. It is often a good idea to span a few different molar ratios to compensate for vagaries in concentration measurements, pipetting, or nuances associated with your DNA molecules. Let's return to our example of inserting a 717 base pair fragment of GFP into Puc19. Let's start by determining how much insert is required for a 1-to-1 molar ratio. We're using Puc19, and after digestion with PST1 and BAMH1, the remaining vector is 2,672 base pairs in length. There is some number of molecules in that 20 nanograms. We do not really care what that exact number is, but we need to know how much of our 717 base pair fragment will have roughly the same number of molecules. We can determine this with a simple ratio. As you can see, we would need 5.4 nanograms of our 717 base pair insert to give an insert to vector ratio of 1 to 1. Ideally, our ligation needs to be in the range of 3 to 1 insert to vector. Once we are done calculating, the simplest thing to do is to dilute your vector to 20 nanograms per microliter and your insert to 5.4 nanograms per microliter. We can then proceed to set up several ligations. This table shows a controlled ligation experiment. The setup is based on having invested time in band purifying digested vector and insert to optimize results. Our no insert control is the control for background colonies, and ideally we would expect no colonies on this plate. As we titrate an insert into the reaction, we should see progressively more colonies. Finally, the molar ratios shown are for a fairly generic ligation. Extremely small or large inserts may require different optimal ratios. If things do not go as expected, you may need to consider more controls to figure out what is going wrong. Let's discuss what each reaction can tell you. Reaction 1 is essentially a transformation control. If you do not see colonies on this plate and no colonies on any other plate, your transformation did not work. Reactions 2 and 3 give you insight into the quality of your vector. Reaction 2 will indicate to you if there are any background colonies from incompletely digested vector that was not cut by either enzyme. Reaction 3 will indicate what kind of background is being contributed by vector that was cut by just one enzyme and then religated. Reactions 4, 5, 6, and 7 are similar to reactions 2 and 3, but are focused on only one enzyme at a time. These might only be necessary if you see significant colonies in reaction 3. The single enzyme digests with no ligation let you see how efficiently each enzyme is working on its own. The single enzyme digests followed by ligation show that each enzyme made a clean compatible end that was able to be ligated and that the ligase itself is working. We are not suggesting that you perform all 7 of these controls for every directional cloning project. If you set up controls 1 and 3 and see expected results, including clones from your ligations that include insert, the rest of these are superfluous. ATP is critical for your ligation to succeed. Some manufacturers include ATP in their buffer concentrates. Other manufacturers provide the ATP as a separate reagent. ATP has low solubility, so make sure that your reaction buffer concentrate or ATP stock is fully thawed and mixed. Avoid the temptation to heat the reaction buffer or the ATP to speed its thawing, as this can actually degrade the ATP. Multiple freeze-thaw cycles can also degrade the ATP, so aliquot your reaction buffer concentrate or your ATP concentrate prior to first use. Okay, so you have studied a fragment you wish to clone and cannot come up with a strategy to do directional cloning. You are going to cut with one enzyme. When using a single enzyme like this, the vector will recircularize unless you stop it. As we discussed, phosphatases remove the 5' phosphate from linear molecules of DNA. The purpose of phosphatase is to prevent linearized vector from closing back on itself by making the 5' end of the linear vector a defective substrate. Complete inactivation or removal is necessary because residual phosphatase activity will inhibit your ligation. This can be accomplished by band purification from a gel or a DNA cleanup column. Much as we discussed with directional cloning, it will be important to monitor your experiment with the appropriate controls to see how all the reagents are behaving. In this series of controls, reaction 1 shows that our transformation worked. In reaction 2, we see linearized vector. If this digest is complete, there will be no colonies. In reaction 3, we are now reclosing the vector, guaranteeing that our ends were not degraded and that the ligation reaction worked. Finally, in reaction 4, we will see exactly how efficient the alkaline phosphatase was in preventing the vector from closing back up and becoming functional. Again, you do not necessarily need to perform all of these controls, but if this is your first time using the reagents, it is a good idea. At a minimum, you should include the phosphatase vector with no insert to monitor the vector-only background. If you are less experienced with molecular biology, the other controls can be added at your discretion. Let's summarize the key tips that you should keep in mind when using restriction enzymes for cloning. 1. When possible, use directional cloning. 2. Set your restriction digest so that the DNA is cut to completion. Then eliminate extra restriction enzymes or insignificant fragments by gel purification of your digested DNA. 3. When setting up ligations, be aware of the correct molar ratio. Span a range of ratios instead of picking just one. 4. Make sure all buffers are fully thawed, dissolved, and evenly mixed. 5. If you cannot perform directional cloning, prevent vector recircularization with alkaline phosphatase. 6. Consider adding alkaline phosphatase to your double-cut vector to further minimize background. This will be particularly useful if one or both of your enzymes is not 100% efficient. To learn more about molecular cloning, visit snapgene.com.